So can I have the, okay, I think it's already there. Honorable ministers, honorable parliamentarians, honorable ambassadors, representatives from national evolution systems, representatives of evolution associations and women organizations, colleagues from the United Nations, multilateral banks, and bilateral aid agencies, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon and welcome to the high-level events on evaluating the SDGs with a no one left behind focus. 2015 has been an historic year. On the one side, 192 heads of states, representatives from civil society and private sector and academia, they met at the UN General Assembly in September to officially endorse the Sustainable Development Goals. On the other hand, the Global Evolution Community, led by EVAL Partner and the UN Evolution Group, declared 2015 as the first ever international year of evaluation. This created a bottom-up global movement that celebrated the International Year of Evaluation in more than 90 events. And it included young evaluators from Africa to up to the UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon, who in April of last year, so almost 1 year ago, exactly in this same room, he was here with us to celebrate the International Year of Evaluation, which, by the way, was also acknowledged by the UN General Assembly. This International Year of Evaluation culminated in November of 2015 at the Global Evaluation Week, at the first ever global evaluation meeting held in a national parliament, in the parliament of Nepal, thanks to the great leadership of Minister Pokharel, who really made possible that at that event, the Speaker of Nepali Parliament, the Prime Minister of Nepal, with several ministers, about 100 parliamentarians from all over the world, plus representative of the global development and evaluation community, they all met together to discuss how evaluation can really transform our development results. At the Global Evaluation Agenda, at the Global Evaluation Week, celebrated at the Parliament of Nepal just a few months ago, several initiatives were launched, including Eval Gender, but most importantly, also the Evaluation Agenda 2016 and 2020 was launched after a 14-month consultations that including, I would say, almost 1,000 of colleagues. The Global Evaluation Week was a clear expression of strengthening and enabling environments for evaluation to inform public policies decision making. It was a clear expression of parliamentarians to engage to strengthen the demand for evaluation in policy making and the use of evaluation in policy making. And it was a clear example of bridging the gap between the policymakers community and the evaluation community. But as I said also, the most important was the endorsement of the Sustainable Development Goals by virtually all countries in the world. And the SDGs are our biggest opportunity to transform our world, at least for five reasons. The first one is that they were developed and identified through a truly participatory process where virtually all the countries in the world were involved. And when I say country, I mean both government, civil society, and the different stakeholders. And therefore, the ownership is expected to be very high. The second reason is that the SDGs are universal. As a colleague of mine just said a few months ago, through the lens of the SDGs, all countries in the world are developing countries. For example, there is no country in the world that already met the SDG 5 on gender equality. So they are all universal and they are relevant to any country in the world. The third big reason is because the SDGs are comprehensive and interconnected. As you know, there are 17 SDGs, and they are around the so-called 5 P's. They're about people, they're about planet, they're about prosperity, they're about peace, because everybody acknowledges that development is not possible without peace, and they're about partnership, because no single individual organization, ministry, or agencies can do it alone. The fourth big reason is that there is a very strong call for leaving no one behind. As you know, there is the SDG 5 that is about gender equality. There is the SDG 10 that is about inequality between countries. But the principle of no one left behind is also mainstream in all the other SDGs. And last but not least, the fifth reason is that the SDGs comes with a strong call for a strong, inclusive, participatory follow-up and review mechanism. They should be based on country-led evaluations. So if on the one side the SDGs are our biggest opportunities, on the other side is also our biggest challenge. How to ensure the implementation of SDGs given the complexity of development? How to ensure we can learn on what works and what does not work for every woman, man, girls, and boy? How to ensure that policymakers, including parliamentarians, demand and use evaluations that are gender responsive to ensure no one is left behind? And how to ensure that national evaluation systems are able to provide gender responsive evidence? This is why EvalGender, the global partnership to strengthen national capacities for equity-focused and gender-responsive evaluations, was created. EvalGender is a multi-stakeholders partnership under the umbrella of Eval Partners that includes parliamentarians, UN agencies, evaluation associations, governments, civil societies, etc., etc. And today's event is just one milestone among an initiative that is covering 2 years. We started with a 2 months global online consultation. We are today and tomorrow here to continue that discussion. And then we will also, through the partnership, deliver technical assistance to countries to strengthen their own national capacities to evaluate SDGs with this particular lens of no one left behind. Today, we are very grateful to the government of Switzerland, Sri Lanka, Tunisia, and the Mexican National Council for Evaluation of Public Policy, CONEVAL, that together with UN Women, UNDP, UNICEF, UNFPA, UNEG, IOC, the Global Parliamentarian Forum for Evaluation, made this event possible. In the next 3 days, we will have more than 200 participants in the room, plus those that are following us online, eager to contribute to this global thinking and to engage to leverage these great opportunities. So it's my big pleasure to have a very diverse panel here with us today. We will have the Deputy Permanent Representative of Switzerland, His Excellency Olivier Zender, who will officially open the high-level event. And then we will have a panel with keynote speakers and keynote panelists. We have Thomas Gass, who is the UNDESA Assistant Secretary General and is responsible for the SDGs from the UN side. We have His Excellency Kabir Hashim, Minister of Public Enterprise Development of Sri Lanka, and also the chair of the Global Parliamentarian Forum for Evaluation. We have Honorable Susan Musioka, Member of Parliament of Kenya, and also the African Regional Representative to the Global Parliamentarian Forum for Evaluation. We have His Excellency Anand Pokharel, Minister of Tourism, Culture, and Civil Aviation from Nepal, and also chair of the Nepali Parliamentarian Forum for Evaluation and South Asian representative to the Global Parliamentarian Forum for Evaluation. We have Ziad Moussa, who is the president of the International Organization for Cooperation and Evaluation, that is the World Federation of the Evaluation Associations, and also co-chair of Eval Partners. And we have Nick York, who is the director of the Human Development and Economic Management of the Independent Evaluation Group at the World Bank. I will pose them three questions. We will have an interaction among the panelists, and after that, there will be time for a question and answer from the audience in the room, as well as the audience online. And finally, His Excellency's Rohan Pereira, the permanent representative of Sri Lanka to the UN, will officially close the high-level event. So without further delay, I would like to invite His Excellency's the Deputy Permanent Representative Switzerland to the UN to come to the stage for the opening remark. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Marco. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. It is a great pleasure for me to be with you today to discuss No One Left Behind, evaluating the SDGs with an equity-focused and gender-responsive lens. Today, we will focus on two important issues for many countries, including my own: the future contribution of evaluation and how can gender perspectives be better integrated in the evaluation work. I will not go back on last year's achievements, which you are all very familiar with. After the adoption of the 2030 agenda, which contain goals and targets on women's rights and gender equality, we now need to focus on implementation. Across the world, many countries are busy mapping out what the new agenda means for the national policies and how its implementation will be undertaken at the national and global level. The MDGs have taught us that we need a robust and monitoring and review framework right from the beginning. Today's side event comes at a very appropriate time. Leaving no one behind means that all women and men, girls and boys, have to be taken on board. A strong follow-up and review mechanism will enable to monitor, evaluate, and demonstrate progress. My country, Switzerland, has been at the forefront of advocating for a strong gender equality goal and the integration of gender equality and women's rights throughout all other goals. From a gender perspective, Agenda 2030 is a major milestone. Switzerland is currently fully engaged in the ongoing debate on how to shape the monitoring and review framework for the new agenda. This framework should enable to measure the implementation of the ambitious goals, be pragmatic and simple, built on existing knowledge, structures, and mechanisms. Switzerland will be amongst the first countries to present a voluntary national report on the SDG implementation in the next HLPF in July this year. On the gender equality, there is still a lot of progress to be achieved in my country. Last week, The Economist published its glass ceiling index, and among the 29 countries listed, Switzerland ranked 26, essentially because of the gender wage gap and insufficient representation of women in boardrooms and parliaments. So, as you said, Sergio, we're far away from SDG 5, but we're working on it. But ladies and gentlemen, there are many ways to design and implement a monitoring and review mechanism. Whatever the approach chosen, the evaluation must enable to assess progress and identify areas of improvement. With the adoption of a General Assembly resolution on evaluation capacity building and the celebration of the 2015 International Year of Evaluation, we have clear signals that this instrument should be used to improve the implementation of the SDGs. In the last decade, the global evaluation community has developed approaches that are equity-focused and gender-responsive. Leaving no one behind is an additional opportunity to further strengthen national evaluation capacities. We are encouraged by today's multi-stakeholders dialogue. As mentioned before, we need to move beyond the MDG focus on numerical targets. We need to adopt an approach that identifies and addresses underlying causes embedded in power relation, access to resources, and cultural norms. In addition, we need to, one, improve linkages between the global, national, and the local level, improve linkages and inclusion of all stakeholders, such as government, civil society, including the disenfranchised, international organizations, and the private sector. And we need to improve our understanding of the social dynamics that perpetrate social inequality and gender inequality. It is key that UN agencies come up with a common approach and programs to support national evaluation systems, as well as to liaise with other major actors collecting data, such as the World Bank. For my country, the support to national statistics could be a system-wide function of the UN development system. Ladies and gentlemen, in order to achieve the full potential of evaluation and ensure the exchange of knowledge, we believe we should focus on the following levels. Firstly, there is a need to strengthen evaluation capacity and national evaluation systems to better evaluate and understand the social norms and gender inequalities. Secondly, we need clear political will for social equity and gender equality. Political awareness and commitments are key to translate knowledge into policy making, national development strategies, and program steering. And thirdly, we need constant inputs from various stakeholders to remind us of our commitments and to propose concrete ways forward. This is the reason why we support EvolGender, this special event, and the workshop that follows. I wish you an inspiring discussion and look forward to listening to your, I hope, bold proposal. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. So this afternoon we have a unique opportunity because we have here panelists coming from not only from different regions, geographical regions, but also from different, let's say, organizational backgrounds. So I would like to pose the first question, first of all, to the colleagues who have a global perspective, and then to the colleagues who have a national perspective. And the first two questions would be, first of all, we hear that the SDGs comes with a follow-up and review mechanism. The first question would be, should this follow-up and review mechanism be designed and implemented in such a way that the principle of no one left behind is fully integrated? And if so, why? But I think that's the easy question. So that's why there is already a second question that is a little bit trickier than the first one. That is, what are the challenges and opportunities to strengthen national capacities to evaluate localized SDGs with a focus on no one left behind? So to start with, I would like to call Thomas Gass to give us the global overview of how this follow-up and review mechanism looks like so far, and what are the plans for the next 12 months, let's say, and what are both the challenges and the opportunities of this. So please.
And all that in 2 minutes. Yeah, no. No, I think it's interesting, Marco, that you're saying, should the evaluation system be set up in such a way that no one is left behind? Actually, yesterday, the Economic and Social Council decided that the first high-level political forum in July, the first one after the adoption of the new agenda, its theme would be to ensure that no one is left behind. So the answer to your first question is, well, because the member states said so, which is something that we in the secretariat like to say anyway. But actually, it's very important for the evaluation committee to community to dig a little bit further and to explore why this is so important. And I really believe that this commitment to leave no one behind is absolutely revolutionary. I'm going to say it in a few moments. But first, a few words about this high-level political forum. We basically have 8 days, ladies and gentlemen, 8 days in which to decide whether the dial is going in the right or in the wrong direction on 17 goals and 169 targets. And as you know, last week, the Statistics Commission has already proposed the indicators for this framework. That is, and all that for 193 countries. Plus all the entities that are not really governmental. I mean, big INGOs, large international companies, big cities, all are not really so easy to subsume into the national data that will be collected in this way. So the challenge right now is to establish this dashboard in such a way that it is firstly relevant to we the people, that there is not a sense, oh, this is going to be yet another UN exercise, and if you don't understand the UN ways, you know, then you can forget it. And then the second one is to make sure that our existing intergovernmental processes that exist around the world, and I mean, the most prominent one we just came out of, let's say the climate change, the conference of the parties on climate change. We are starting yesterday the Commission on the Status of Women, the Human Rights Council, the Commission on the Committee on the World Food Security, etc. We need to make sure that all these intergovernmental spaces where our line ministries meet, where with the experts on these topics, that all these entities can connect to the to this dashboard, that they can be like the docking stations, if you want, for this dashboard. Now, in doing so, we need to be very careful that when we evaluate goal 2, for example, on food and agriculture, and I need to be careful, I saw someone from IFAD here, etc. But honestly, when we look at goal 2, we need to be careful that we don't have on the panel just the director of FAO, IFAD, and WFP. We need to make sure that on the panel we have the chair of the Human Rights Council, the chair of the Committee on World Food Security, someone from UNEA, someone maybe from the Board for Sustainable Industrialization, etc. So we really use the integrative force of this agenda. Now, I know I've already passed, you're gonna give me the yellow card soon, but let me just say a few words about this leaving no one behind, because really, the Millennium Development Goals was all about reducing poverty by half. So we set ourselves up to fail. I mean, we already agreed from the beginning that we would choose the easy half, obviously. And so when after 15 years we say, oh, there are still pockets of poverty and you know, poverty is unequal in countries, obviously, we never decided that we would go further. And here, by virtue of this very participative process involving 193 countries, you all, civil society, interest groups that came, that pushed open the doors of the UN and let the oxygen in, let the emotional intelligence come out of this organization. By virtue of this, we have an agenda that is not just integrated, as Mr. Zehnder just said, not just very holistic and comprehensive, but is committed to leaving no one behind. Meaning that we, and this is so important, because when you start an evaluation, you always look at, you know, what was meant. Huh? Yeah. Otherwise, that's your first question in an evaluation, is what was intended. The intention is that we start our strategic process by asking, who are the most vulnerable? And why are they vulnerable? And so our evaluations have to deliver that. And that's where a lot of the difficulties come. And I'll leave some for my colleagues here.
Thank you very much. I mean, very, very interesting. So you mentioned, you know, that one of the challenges, how to make sure that we the people can connect with all this discussion, how to make sure that, you know, that we ensure that oxygen comes in, when you were referring also to the civil societies. So I would like to ask to Ziad Musa, who is here representing the civil society. So what's your take in these issues?
Yeah, thank you, Marco. Actually, I was thinking to myself, what is like a right metaphor for no one left behind? I worked at some point in my life as a school teacher, and one of the silliest jokes when we were going on a trip was, if anybody is not here, please raise your hand. But these normally would be the ones left behind. But technically, those who are not on the bus are probably those with a disability who cannot go in the bus, are those who cannot afford the trip, are those who through cultural constraints cannot, have not been allowed with their parents to take part of the trip. And technically, what you know, educators do is that we move with the bus with whomever is here. So no one is left behind would have meant that there are two sets or two teams of educators. One to move with the train, as Thomas has just said, making sure that it is on target. And another team is looking at every condition, making sure, for example, that the bus is fit for those who are disabled, that there's enough negotiations on cultural sensitivities and what have you so that they can join the train or the bus or what have you. So to me, is giving that additional attention to those we normally do not give attention to. And when you look at the magnitude, the 17 and 193 countries and et cetera, it's too big, you know, under the present circumstances to allow for this special attention, despite all the goodwill and despite involving the civil society from the beginning, or I would say other stakeholders than I would say official stakeholders from the beginning. I would, for the sake of time, I would just highlight two opportunities and then maybe two challenges. One of the opportunities is that, unlike their predecessors, the SDGs are country-led and have given a very close attention to participation throughout the different phases of their development, and they involve Switzerland and my little country, Lebanon, who used to be the Switzerland of the Middle East anyway. You know, on equal foot. And that's by itself an opportunity. The other thing is that probably in their complexity, they're so complex that there wouldn't be a one-size-fits-all approach. So there is not a parachuted model, follow this, and you're on track, don't follow this, and you're not on track. And these are very interesting opportunities in the sense that they can be humanized, democratized, etc. Now, in terms of challenges, I see one very important challenge, which can also be linked to an opportunity, which is ownership. Unlike MDGs, Human Development Indexes, what have you, where there's always an official position and a civil society position, the process of developing the SDGs and the whole mindset around the SDGs allows for, I would say, a greater ownership around them. But the challenge is, how not to leave anybody behind, otherwise this ownership would be missing. Now you tell me it's quite impossible to align the views of the UN and of the civil society and of the various donors and the various stakeholders. I can tell you that it is happening under that famous Eval Partners that you heard, where the United Nations Evaluation Group, where the IOCE and the whole evaluation associations, the parliamentarians, the foundations, the big donors, the topical interest groups, youth, gender, etc., are sitting around the same table and negotiating a consensus. And we know from experience that it's not easy, but it's not impossible at the same time. So ownership, to me, is one thing. The other thing is the different level of maturities of the national system. Since the SDGs are mainly driven nationally and country-led, we have to take this into account when approaching the evaluability or the evaluation of the SDGs. And last but not least, there's a latent danger of inertia. And by inertia, we mean this is so complicated, we don't master the UN language, so basta, we're not engaging in this. And this is more dangerous, you know, than not having a framework from the beginning, because that also, again, risks of leaving others behind, and we can probably develop all of these in the question and answers.
Thank you very much. I mean, interesting as usual. So Nick, I mean, Ziad was talking about the importance of to ensure that evaluation should be culturally sensitive. He was talking about the issue of complexity, no one size fit all formula will not work. He was asking how to ensure that those who are not in the bus this time can be in the bus. So from your perspective, also sitting in an international multilateral organizations, I mean, how do you see these challenges and what could be the opportunity to build upon?
Well, thank you very much, Marco, and it's a pleasure to be here. I'm sorry I'm not Caroline, which has made your panel somewhat less diverse than it should have been. Anyway, I'll try and do my best to reflect on. I'd like to draw on evaluation evidence in replying. Three sorts of evaluation evidence that we have gathered, and I'm sure would be quite familiar from your own experiences, many of you having looked at the same issues. The first is vast experience of evaluating development interventions at project level and program level, where I think almost every evaluation I've seen says, don't start something that's too complicated, don't start something where you don't know how it's going to work, and be selective, and make sure you get ownership, and so on. And then make sure you have a strong M&E framework. Particularly make sure that it all joins up. So that's one piece of evidence. Another piece of evidence is a major evaluation we've just done of one of the two twin goals of the World Bank, which is obviously part of the SDGs as well, which is eliminating extreme poverty by 2030. And then the third piece of evidence would be our own experience with applying the MDGs as a global goal in the World Bank group. And I'm afraid my heart sinks when I hear this, because we appear to be marching into a program of work where we could make all the mistakes that we've learned from evidence we shouldn't make. One, as I've just implied, is not knowing really whether the goals that you're taking on and the whole thing that you're signing up to is achievable, is practical, is realistic. In other words, are we being selective and do we know what the theory of change is? And the second is making sure that you don't just look at the M&E side of it on its own, but you integrate it with clear understanding of the problem, clear understanding of how you're going to address the problem, your strategy, and the feedback loops, and so on. So in terms of your question, should we sign up to leaving no one behind? I mean, I don't think anybody in the room would disagree with the underlying objectives of leaving no one behind, but how can I sign up to something which I don't know what it is? I mean, I don't know what leaving no one behind means, because I don't think it's been defined. As far as I know, it's mainstreaming it into the SDGs is clear, the commitment is clear, the ownership is clear, but what it is not clear. So one way to get clarity on that would be to think about the objective in relation to the diagnostics, the analysis, the theory of change at country level, and then decide what that means in terms of indicators, targets, and what you can sign up to. Then at least it would be in the context of a practical theory of change and chain of analysis, which would suggest that you were likely to succeed. All the evaluation evidence points that if you don't do that process, you will fail. The experience in the World Bank group of applying the poverty goal, which we looked at very, very thoroughly, and of course it's very new, suggests that the constraints will be data. 57% of bank staff surveyed said that government capacity to gather data will be the major constraint, and about the same percentage of clients surveyed, government country representatives and other clients surveyed, said that the constraint will be lack of resources to gather the data. So that we know is a, you know, that is what we're up against. Our own evaluation found that ownership at the global level of a set of goals is a long, long way from translating into action at country level, because you have to go through the chain, even within an organization like the World Bank. Getting ownership right from the top down to the bottom is no trivial task. So to do it in a complex system of the one that you've just described with so many partners, must it by definition be even more complicated? So we know that this is going to be tough, and we know that things have not worked in the past. So I would just say, can we be realistic and try and learn from experience and try and focus it in that system-driven way and with a clear theory of change about how it would work? And then we can answer the question, what are we signing up to, and will it, you know, I don't want to sign up to something I can't deliver. And I know that the World Bank Group is signed up to very important goals that are exactly aligned with the original question. Eliminating extreme poverty, promoting shared prosperity, mainstreaming gender, and many other related commitments. So I don't think anybody's in doubt about the goodwill there, but the evaluation evidence is sobering.
Thank you very much. So, I mean, you mentioned really about the challenge of translating these global commitments to action at country level. You also were talking about the importance of having clear theory of change, but perhaps the question would be, should this theory of change be at global level, or they should be at national and local level? So I would like to take these two questions and to bridge and to move from the global level to the national level. And perhaps I would like to start with Minister Kabir Hashim, because in addition of being a minister, he has been also one of the key champions among the parliamentarians to move forward these kind of discussions among parliamentarians to strengthen both the enabling environment for evaluation, but also the demand for evaluation from parliamentarians. So, Minister Kabir, I mean, what's your take on this discussion?
Thank you, Marco. Well, I think now it's going to be the tough part for you because you managed the time well, but with three parliamentarians
yeah,
here,
<yes. laughs>
I don't know whether you can manage time with us. Well, you can guess there's quite a lot of parliamentarians, which is unusual for an evaluation discussion. But there's so much of participation, I guess, because we always felt we were the ones who were left behind. So that's why I think we are very much involved here. So if the key performance indices were structured without including gender and or equity, what would it be like? What would we really miss? That was the real question behind your first question. Measuring development without gender or equity would really lead to a lot of distorted conclusions, if you look at all what has happened in the past. And if MDGs had really achieved its targets, then we wouldn't be talking about SDGs because no one would have been left behind really. So in that sense, if you look around, there's in the last couple of years, there's been a lot of gender disparities, income inequalities, which has grown rapidly. And this has become a problem. And if you take examples of regions or countries, the problem is real. If you take the developing countries, there are over 35 million girls who do not attend schools, and two-thirds of these girls are members of ethnic minority communities. If you also look at a country like Guatemala, the illiteracy rate among indigenous women living in Guatemala is double that of those non-indigenous people. I would also just take a look at my own country, Sri Lanka. In the past, we had high economic growth rates, 7% growth rate. We've elevated to a middle-income country, but statistics say that 42% of the people in Sri Lanka live at an income below $2 a day. So growth has not been inclusive. If you also measure the national poverty level in Sri Lanka, it says it's 6%, but if you take regional poverty levels, out of the 25 districts in Sri Lanka, over 16 districts have poverty levels which range from 16 to 28%. So the national average is completely out. So again, inclusivity was a problem. So the reason that SDGs should be evaluated with an approach that no one is left behind is critical. If you're going to look at real problems that are occurring all over, especially in regions such as mine in South Asia, where there's a huge issue of poverty. And poverty actually, again, comes from inequality. So that in that sense, income inequalities have been one of the major problems. And I think the SDG targets really looks into this very carefully. From the other side, if you also look at figures, two-thirds of the extremely poor from the low-income or middle-income countries, if you take two-thirds of the extremely poor in those households, the head of those households have been ethnic minorities. Again, an issue of inclusivity. And three-fourths of extremely poor people from these countries are from rural areas, again, leaving a section of people out. 80% of people with disabilities live in the developing countries. So this really is a problem. And then if you look at capacity, actually we talk about the challenges and the opportunities to strengthen national capacities. Well, I think this is an issue that we need to take care of before we talk about evaluating the SDGs. Because one of the things I look at the challenges as many, socio-cultural challenges, political challenges, technical challenges, financial challenges, amongst the other many challenges that we have. When I talk about socio-cultural, the attitudes of a country, of society, about inclusivity, about evaluations, the need for it, the perceptions and attitudes of people are critical in ensuring that we can get the evaluation of SDGs with a focus on gender and equity. That's very important. And if you look at the technical issues, one of the things is you need to build a framework where targets and indicators should be designed to reduce existing inequalities and to address entrenched discrimination to actually realize the social and economic rights of these people who are most in need. And from the other side, if you look at the challenges of developing indicators to measure the realization of urgent social and economic needs of the most marginalized populations. So you need to build those indicators in. So that those technical support we need, which we have an issue of capacity. We already have issues of evaluation frameworks in our countries without having these indicators in. So which means that you have a capacity issue and you need to build these capacities. And apart from that, if you also look at the KPIs, we also need to develop these indicators at the same time. But we have other issues with indicators. We have issues that some of the indicators are complex, some are difficult to build. We don't have the necessary resource people. This all comes in together. Then one of the main things we see also is the issue of the political challenge. The political challenge is where do you have the political leadership? If you really look at who are the majority of end users of evaluation, the majority of end users of evaluation are government and parliament. But how much of government and parliament are really immersed in using evaluation? In parliament especially, we hardly use it because you hardly have the capacity or you don't have the resources to use it. So getting the political buy-in becomes totally important. So that's why we actually started involving the Parliamentary Forum for Development Evaluation, because some of us realized that it's something that we need. We should be demanding it, and we think that we should work with the evaluation community to take this forward. So this is a good time for the SDGs.
Thank you very much, Minister Kabir. Actually, I think you have been exemplary in using data to substantiate your arguments. So it looked like hearing an evaluator talking. So you talk about the importance of political leadership because really for an enabling environment for using evaluation in policy making, national policy making, you really need both parliamentarians but also ministers, etc., really to buy in the culture of using evidence to argue for policy decisions. And Minister Pocarel has been really a great example when it comes to political leadership. I mean, thanks to his political leadership, now in the new constitution of Nepal, the principle that public policies should be evaluated has been included. Thanks his own political leadership, a new law to implement that principle that has been included in the constitution is about to be passed at the discussed and passed at the parliament. Thanks to his political leadership, there is a Nepali parliamentarian forum or caucuses for evaluation. And once again, as already mentioned in the introductory remark, thanks to his leadership, we have been able to convene hundreds of parliamentarians and leaders at the Parliament of Nepal, together with the Speaker, with the Prime Minister, to talk exactly about what's needed to tackle some of the challenges of evaluating national policies with the lens of no one left behind. So with this, I would like to ask Minister Pocarel to share your views on these issues.
Thank you, Mr. Marco, panelist, excellency, and audience, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me immense pleasure and opportunity to address in this high-level panel, No One Left Behind, but I want to use another terminology, No Nepal Left Behind. I am country of Mount Everest and country of birthplace of Buddha and Buddhism, but I am now a country of the damage of devastating earthquake. Then I use the term No Nepal Left Behind. Otherwise, there will be no justice. As most of you know, Nepal had a privilege to constitute the first parliamentarians forum and co-host the historic Evil Week event in November 2015 that declared global parliamentarian forums on development evaluation. A special event was organized in the Legislative Parliament of Nepal, which also launched the evaluation agenda of 2016 to 2020, Evil SDGs, Evil Gender Plus, and Evil Youth Plus. That was the most important achievement in that event. We are committed to develop evaluation and have taken steps to ensure it. And today, I also agree that SDGs should be evaluated with the focus on no one left behind. We have been talking about equity on all folds. However, our policy and practice in developing countries have been biased based on gender. Even though in Nepal, in new constitution, there is a provision of 30% women in parliament in national level, as well as 50% women in local level. Now, it is the good message to you also. Our president is women, and speaker is also women, and very soon, Chief Justice, Madam Sarmila, will be nominated. Then you can imagine there is the gender-friendly system in Nepal. In Nepal, our country have ensured equity and gender-responsive and proportional participation. We now have a female president and female speaker, and also prospective Chief Justice. We have ensured 30% women participation in parliament and 50% local level. However, we have to collaborate and work together to make sure we take this to grassroots level also. In order to materialize the idea of no one left behind, there is a need to reorient our traditional practice of evaluation to more equity focused and gender responsive. In the context of Nepal, exclusion based on social group, gender, and remote region was rooted since decade. We have formulated a new constitution in 2015 that has incorporated all global human rights principles and has made various inclusive provisions to address the issue of exclusion. Our present government has started to implement this federal constitution, which has a special provision to promote equity-focused development that benefits the excluded based on social group, gender, or who is isolated due to his or her residency in remote area. Today, when we talk about evaluating SDG with an equity-focused and gender-responsive lens, I think we parliamentarians have a very crucial role to play. It is also important in the context of SDGs. It is because when we talk about SDG-friendly policies or realization of SDG by 2030, there is a need to make our policy system and practices equity-focused and gender-responsive. This is also important in order to materialize the concept leaving no behind, because achievement of SDGs should be beyond achieving the quantity target at the aggregate national level. The SDGs are comprehensive and somewhat ambitious goal to be realized by 2030. In order to achieve the noble goals and target of SDGs, we need huge investment, improve implementation, effectiveness, and institutionalization system to closely monitor the performance and evaluate the result of each goal. Parliamentarians can play crucial role to bring out SDG friendly policy and oversight for their effective implementation. In Nepal, we have initiated practice of building evaluation capacity of the parliamentarians, but it needs to be scaled up both in terms of equity and gender resilience. In order to make this happen, we need to aim our act and regulation, retune our planning and monitoring and evaluation process in line with equity-based principles. We have drafted a separate monitoring and evaluation act and plan to refine our ME guidelines where we can incorporate the approach. Again, capacity to evaluate the SDG and national development policies strategy with an equity focus and gender responsive lens is crucially important. So our focus should be to empower the evaluation commission and organizers, members, to focus our discussion on evaluating SDG with an equity-focused and gender-responsive lens. Let us discuss the way of mobilizing our network of parliamentarians forum to help build evaluation of capacities and extend it to various areas of equity and gender-responsiveness. We can explore a range of events that provide avenues for sharing experience and joint learning in this field where support of the development partners is instrumental. Once again, thanks to organizers for this great opportunity and to all audience for listening to me. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister Pokharel. I saw you already moved also to the next questions with some of the way of to address some of the challenges, but also the opportunities that we have. So thanks a lot for that you covered also already the third questions. I'm sure you have noticed that the only woman in the panel has left behind.
As usual.
But that was to give you the opportunity to give speak. You twice the time
to speak
available to speak. And also to build on some of the discussion that is going on and to transition us to the next question. So if you can cover both the first two questions, but then also help us in transition to the next question that is the one that Minister Pokharel already addressed, that is really, what are the key ways to address these challenges and also to build on the opportunities that we have. So really, if you can help us to move to the forward-looking aspect of this discussion. And as I said, you have the double time of any other panelists to tackle these issues. So, Honorable Susan Masioka, the floor is yours.
Masioka. Thank you very much, Marco. Yes. Having no one left behind is very, very important. I agree with all the panelists that it is the way to go, and it is important that we, right from the onset, we involve everybody. The United States president visited Kenya recently, and he said, talking about women not being involved, he talked about having a football game and only one team playing. If you have the other team sitting down, then it's not a game. And in most cases, we have women being left behind. We have the persons with disability, the children, the youth, and marginalized groups not being recognized in many, many activities that concern them. I like the idea of evaluating the SDGs and having no one left behind. And I would like to say that it's not just at the evaluation stage, it's also right from the beginning and right from the ongoing processes that have been initiated it is important that we involve everybody who is being targeted for whatever programs that are being implemented. So all those affected must be carried along and involved if meaningful progress is to be achieved. When we talk about women issues, I am elected on an affirmative action platform, and we know the struggle women have gone through. We have had those international conferences, resolutions, Mexico, Nairobi, Beijing, and various declarations about getting women on board. It's not until the efforts that are being made today to put women in decision-making processes that we can see some changes taking place. In Kenya, through this affirmative action seat, we have managed to have 19% of women parliamentarians in parliament. But our target is to have 30%, and we are working on a formula for that. And I hope in the next election we'll have that formula on. So it is important to put everybody on board, and no one should be left behind. The challenges, as I see them, SDGs are complex, interconnected, and some of them overlapping and interlinked. When we have national programs and policies to implement, we have line ministries handling specific issues. Now, interlinking them sometimes, many times, becomes a problem, especially on issue of budgeting and allocation of funds. So this is one of the challenges that I see. And also the national evaluation systems, as far as evaluation of SDGs is concerned, they will require the involvement of more stakeholders. And also we require to have more capacity building for the government bodies. And the time span for some of these evaluation varies from ministry to ministry, from country to country, and this also might be a challenge. The issues of social equity and gender equality in themselves is already a challenge to many communities and governments. Cultural issues come into place, and lack of well-coordinated gender mainstreaming policies that are poorly implemented. This will be difficult to monitor and evaluate. Shortages and lack of expertise, especially in many of our countries, will also be a challenge. And allocation of resources, especially by government bodies to evaluation processes, we might have inadequate allocation of funding, and therefore making the evaluation not effective. Talking about overcoming the challenges, we need to put a lot of effort to strengthen the national capacities and to handle the evaluation. We need to increase public participation. The public is now quite aware, and with the social media and all, a lot of communication goes on, and people are demanding their rights, and also need to know what is happening, and also to be involved in the evaluation processes, and to be given the correct information and data, like the data that is always generated by the evaluation and the research research organizations. The executive needs to be more responsive and take action and allocate the resources, and also develop the monitoring and evaluation policies in the countries so that we can have proper documentation in time and use of the evaluation material. So there should be increased attention on performance and the monitoring of outcomes and vibrant VOPES, like the evaluation societies, to be recognized and to be allowed to play, to do their work, not to be left behind, so that they can produce relevant results that can be used. Universities and training programs, they need also to come on board and produce quality quality education and the right information that is necessary to conduct proper evaluation. So the research departments also, and I think the increased demand for monitoring and evaluation to inform decision makers should be addressed. And I'd like also to emphasize that the parliamentarians all over the world should be more involved and more ready to use the data that is generated so that they make proper decisions and develop the policies that are necessary. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Susan, for a very clear overview of what are the challenges and opportunities. And I think that you describe very clearly the aspect of strengthening national capacities, both for the demand side, the parliamentarian, the executive, et cetera, as well as the supply side, the evolution association, et cetera, to provide the strong evidence to inform decision making. And that should be done in partnership with the different stakeholders, yes, parliamentarians, evolution association, government, et cetera, in the country. So with this, perhaps I would like to transit once again back to Kabir, because you have been in the driving seat, especially when it comes with the parliamentarians, in strengthening the demand side of the equation of the enabling environment for evaluation. So from where you sit now as chair of the Global Parliamentarian Forum, what are the two, three key priorities that you think that the Global Parliamentarian Forum should work in the next 1 or 2 years to tackle some of these challenges?
Yeah, the initial reason for working on the Global Parliamentarians Forum was because we felt there was a disconnect between the politicians and the evaluation community. And we needed to complement each other. That was a necessity. So we started lobbying towards, you know, it should have come the other way around, but we as parliamentarians lobbied to attend evaluation conferences, workshops, and said that, you know, eventually the demand for evaluation rests with the government. It's important to use it. So we looked at the challenges. Why is it that evaluation is not being adopted so easily? One thing is when you're in the opposition, you're always looking for evaluation reports and you're using it against the government. And, you know, the moment you come into government, then you forget about all those details and then you play a different role. But right now you can see there are two ministers here. Both of us are in the government, but we are still in the evaluation group, we're still demanding for evaluation because we believe that it is something that will work to our advantage, that it is important for us. But the issue is, it's not that parliamentarians or politicians are not interested in evaluation, or not that they don't care for using evaluation, but it is more complex than that. The issue is that there is a disconnect. Parliamentarians or politicians don't have much time to do reading, to go into material for the usual thing is that, you know, the usual saying is that a politician has only a 10 minutes reading time for a day, basically including reading the newspapers. And that's quite true because he doesn't get time to go through huge documents. And you give a politician a 80-page evaluation report, he's not going to look at it, right? He has got no time to look at that. And he's not going to understand the complexities. So therefore, there is a problem about using evaluation reports. So in that sense, we've been lobbying now that parliamentarians' capacity building has to be built. And not only looking at parliamentarians individually, we're looking about capacity building of parliaments itself. So we're talking about a MNE unit in parliament. And then we have an issue, Marco, that if you look at the accountability accounting process, public accounting process is changing from activities and processes to more results oriented. So that's a good sign. So we need to strengthen the Auditor General's department. We need more funding for that. So in all that, one of the issues is parliamentarians need to be more aware, and that's why we believe that we should have the forum that will cross-link with the evaluation community, that will exchange ideas, support each other, and get more knowledge. Now, that's one thing we are working on. The other thing is that if you are going to work with SDGs, if you're going to have gender responsive and equity focused evaluations, you need capacity. And for that, you need to have a lot of support. So there we need you need the political will to get this done. And there we have an issue of how many parliaments in the world do actually have a national evaluation policy. We did a regional mapping, and I think it came to something like 20 countries. Less than 20 countries. So that means most countries don't have an evaluation policy or don't really adopt it. Now, unless you make it mandatory sometimes, some things don't happen. So one of the key focuses on the parliamentary forum is to lobby for a national evaluation policy in each country. Because if you have an evaluation policy, you get it institutionalized, you get the funding for supporting evaluation and the processes and for capacity building. So we think we can leverage these things, because right now the opportunities are, I spoke about political champions. If you look at some of the countries where evaluation has grown, you've always had a political champion, either in a minister or in a president or in a prime minister. I like to quote from my own country, in the last 1 year, we have a political champion in our own prime minister, because we've changed the election system, we've made it mandatory for women to hold 30% of the local government seats. We haven't had even 5%. We've made it mandatory that 30% by affirmative action must be women. We also are doing changes to the constitution, amending the constitution to bring in more inclusivity for marginalized groups. Now, this all happens because you have political leadership. If you don't have that political buy-in, you don't get to achieve these targets. So it's critical that the evaluation community works with the political community. And now that you can leverage that opportunity because politicians are getting involved. Mm-hmm. So I think there is a huge opportunity.
Thanks a lot, Amina. So Honorable Susan said that it's very important, the partnership. So she talked about parliamentarians, and you very clearly explained what are the concrete actions that the Global Parliamentarian Forums are targeting for the next near future. But Susan also talked about the importance of civil society. So I would like to go back to Ziad and ask, from the civil society perspective, what are the concrete actions that or priority that you would see for the next few months or few years?
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't be telling a secret if it's, again, partnerships, but from a civil society angle. And a good example of these partnerships that they can work is the Global Evaluation Agenda 2016-2020 that you introduced in your introductory remarks. I mean, if you look at the Global Evaluation Agenda, it's co-signed by IOCE, but also by UNEG, and it has been launched in the Parliament. And you know, it provides a full description on what should happen at the individual level, at the system level, at the enabling environment level, at the interlinkages between those. So for us, and here, although I'm talking from a civil society angle, when I talk about the agenda, I talk about us who are here and us who are in the room. We have a wide menu, and our mantra in the next 4 years is, what bite of the eval apple would be yours? Obviously, it's too big to be eaten up. We're in the Big Apple City, and when we were imagining the logo, we bumped into the problem of the visualization of the apple, as I see many apples on many computers here. But the whole idea from it is that what part of the Eval apple is yours and you're going to be working on. Now, if many of us will be working in converging directions, that would be awesome. In case we will go back to the old model where we have our own chasse gardée and our agendas, individual agendas, then definitely that's a predicament for another wall the bus is heading straight into. Another way to overcome these challenges, and again, it's no secret after what has been introduced, is national evaluation capacity. Yeah. And when we talk about national evaluation capacity, we have to be aware that it goes beyond statistics. I've looked back and forth into the SDG declaration, and although evaluation as a word is mentioned twice, there are a lot of accompanying measures in several instances. We talk about disaggregated data, about means of collecting data, but also about statistics, which seems to be like a flagship innovation or a flagship added value in the implementation of the agenda. Now, statistics is very important. I mean, yeah. Us evaluators suffer a lot because you don't have valid statistics as your departing point. But the statistics are not only the ending point, in the sense that the whole discourse about equity is difficultly measured by statistics. If I look around me, like Syrian kids who are on the street versus Syrian kids who are in the school, I mean, if they go to school 2 hours a day and follow a mashed up curriculum, this is not going to lead elsewhere. Moreover, the equity dimension, and I'll be closing my intervention on that, a friend working in Latin America with landless women farmers once told me that through an empowerment program, he would observe that when the landlord comes to collect the money from the women, they wouldn't dare look him in the eyes. And through an empowerment program, they could pay and look the landlord in the eyes. And that's a dimension that cannot be captured by statistics, and that is, you know, the road to equity. I don't say that there's a silver bullet or a golden standard or what have you to measure these, but all what I'm saying is that these are as important as numbers, as the easy half or as the difficult half, and need to be factored in when we approach the SDGs.
Thanks a lot, Ziad, and also thanks for referring back to the Global Evaluation Agenda that, just as a reminder, was officially launched during the Global Evaluation Week at the Parliament of Nepal in November last year. Mm-hmm. And as a reminder, in the Global Evaluation Agenda, among other principles, there are two that I would like to remind. One is the principle, no one left behind, is very much there. No one left behind, gender equality, human rights, etc., is very much there. But the other principle is about the country-led evaluation. It's about the fact that country should be on the driving seat. And that's why I think it's very important to hear from parliamentarians, government, and civil society from different countries. But obviously, there is also a role to be played by international organizations. And that's why I would like to ask Nick, from your side, you know, from the World Bank and the global development world, what should be the priority, the key priorities to address the challenges that we have been talking about and really to leverage the opportunities that we have been talking about?
I'm very happy to try and answer that. So just starting on the country-led angle of this, I completely agree that is central to this, otherwise there's no way of joining things up in a way which is likely to work. And of course it is completely right from all points of view. From the World Bank's perspective particularly, it's very noticeable how the income and GDP growth over the last few years and the shift in the relationships has already started to move things in a better way, in that the donors are not by any means as much in the driving seat as they were when I started in development about, 15 years ago. And I think that's a very good thing. That's the only way that we're going to do this. If I can just break down what I think the priorities are into the bits of the cycle that I was talking about earlier. So data, diagnostics, strategic setting of objectives and choice of interventions, and then the feedback loop. On data, clearly investing in household surveys, oversampling for the vulnerable groups in order to have good data that can mesh with administrative data at national level is vital. In order to get that, you need statistical capacity building, and there's been very good work done by the UN and other partners, including the World Bank, with national governments, and that, I think, needs to be strengthened further. I think evaluation capacity building could have a much higher profile alongside statistical capacity building. In the evaluation capacity building, the sorts of things that would make the difference would be ramping up of, obviously, South-South learning from countries which are very good at this, like South Africa or Mexico. South Africa's just started a tripartite initiative with Uganda and Benin, which is a very, very good thing to see. And Mexico has been extremely helpful to other partners. Also, increasing the availability of master's and graduate courses in evaluation in developing countries, which is, you see more of that now in these regional centers, which we've supported in South Africa, Senegal, Shanghai, and so on. But I think that needs to be coordinated and led by planning and finance ministries in countries. They could play a big role. If you look at what South Africa has done, it isn't just an evaluation capacity development, it's a results system that they've developed there, and it's very impressive. Unfortunately, South Africa is also the most unequal country in the world, so they really do need a system which will help to ensure no one is left behind. Then there's the diagnostic side of it. I don't think it's obvious usually what the problem is, and as I said earlier on, we need to define the problem in order to solve it. But for example, the bank's systematic country diagnostics meshing with poverty mapping and poverty analysis would be part of the solution, and trying to look more at distribution aspects. I think much more impact evaluation work for these vulnerable groups is to be commended as well. I think we find that the evidence is that it has to be both direct and indirect ways of tackling the groups left behind and poverty in general. So it's not just about promoting growth, but it's also about looking at very targeted interventions. And if I can give some examples of interventions which I think are particularly important for the groups left behind, one would be early childhood development work. We just did a major evaluation on that, and it's an area which is, I think most people would recognize as important in the UN. Girls' education, tackling child marriage, addressing sanitation, sexual reproductive health, land reform. It shouldn't actually just be that women can look landlords in the eye. They should be the landladies, you know? I mean, it should go well beyond that. But I agree with you in terms of what you were saying. I think social protection, disaster risk reduction, all these types of interventions are disproportionately beneficial to the groups we're talking about. There are certain points in a life where if you're left behind, you're always going to be left behind. And early childhood nutrition is very, very important there. Girls' education is vital because that means you're left behind yourself and also your future generations end up being left behind. And then, of course, on the M&E and feedback side of things, I think there's some obvious things we can do, like better disaggregation of data, measuring the outcomes on these targeted items, but particularly piloting about scaling up. It's all very well identifying what works, but if we're going to bring in private sector investment to address the SDGs, we need ways of knowing what is scalable and will lever in money that's not currently in the system. So the only way to try that is to pilot new approaches, because it's not happening at the moment, not widely anyway. For example, the IFC part of the World Bank Group is not particularly strong on development. I have to say, the evidence tends to show it's better at looking at performance and other objectives than bringing in the development objectives that we're talking about. So there's a lot to learn even within our organization, but more generally bring in the private sector. And I think also M&E can help with flexing things midstream. If projects are not working because they've been too ambitious or not selective or unclear on their results, then you need mechanisms which will stop them after a year or 2 years before they waste any more money. And so I think midstream evaluation and M&E that works for that is very, very important. So I think there are bits all the way along the chain that we can do that would really make a big difference.
Thank you very much, Nick. So we started the conversation with Thomas from the UN, and now to close the conversation, I would like to go back to Thomas and really, you know, from where you sit, that you really have this global overview. How do you see the priority should be in the next 1 or 2 years to ensure that also evaluation is not leaving anybody behind?
I mean, I would agree with what has been said here, especially in the second round. I mean, the importance of political will, the importance of giving the right instrument and tools to the people who need them, to the decision makers, making sure that the data is there, that it is disaggregated, that it's not just about statistics, but also about the capacity to evaluate and to communicate that evaluation, that it doesn't just come across in 80-page documents, but in something that can be politically usable. But as we move, I'm gonna take it back to that level and just say, let's make sure as we move into this new era that we fully understand that we are no longer talking of a strategic plan for the aid industry. This is a shared vision of humanity. And I have good news for those who find it daunting. It is daunting, but the 193, you know, leaders of countries have signed on to it and have promised it to their people. So we don't have to have any problem. We don't have to choose whether to sign on or not. It's been decided. This is the way we're going to go for the next 15 years. And now what we need to do is we need to make this into a social contract between the leaders and the people, between the duty bearers and the rights holders. And these instruments, evaluation, statistics, etc., are crucial for that. But we also need to have more of a debate at the national level, because if you take the 17 goals and the 169 targets, of course it's an impossible project, because it's not a project. It's a shared vision of where we want to be as a humanity, which means at the national level, we have to design the plans and the strategies and the projects to make sure that we reach there. And that still has to be done. And it has to be done with all the experience and the science, but it also has to be done with a real dialogue with the people. And I think that's where we still have a lot to learn. And I may sound a little bit as the philosopher here in the room, but I consider myself as a development practitioner. I have log frames in my DNA, you know. But I can tell you something, yeah, this is now no longer the same. And so I would say, if I was a strategic planner and I wanted to put two strategic planning questions to everyone in the room, to all of our organizations, I would just ask these two questions. You know, first question, are we strengthening the relationship between the duty bearers and the rights holders? And the second question, who are we leaving behind? I think if we can answer those two questions, and that's not rocket science, then I think we are getting onto that path of the 2030 agenda.
Thank you very much for these very inspiring comments. And please join me in a round of applause for the panelists who have been very, very insightful, but also very good in keeping the time so that we still have half an hour for the question and answer. That I was very keen to have this half an hour for question and answer.
So I would like to open the room for this question and answer. Just with two, please, and I already see hands on, but just two, please. The first one, if you can be as short as possible, staying on the point, and the second, if you can introduce yourself before talking so that we can understand where are you from, etc. So we have two mics. So there is one, two, three, four, five, and six. Oh, seven, eight, and then we close the first round of questions. And just as a reminder also, those who are following online, if you can post your question in the Twitter stream. I don't know if they will be projected or not. But then we will have a colleague selecting few questions and asking those questions. So please.
Thanks to everyone. Richard Jordan from the Royal Academy of Science International Trust with a quick comment on Nick's last remarks. On December 22nd, the General Assembly of the UN adopted the International Day of Women and Girls in Science. Girls who are 12 this year will be 27 in 2030. And the director of our academy, Princess Dr. Nisreen Al-Hashemite, is working very hard to encourage girls not to go into just STEM, science, technology, engineering, math, but also statistics and evaluation. Thank you.
So not only landlords, but also scientists.
That's good.
And evaluators. Who was the second one? There was a second hand on that side. Okay, no? Okay, so then we move more on this side. Okay. We have four hands here.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Mal Said. I represent Eval Gender for Eval MENA, that is civic society. And I'm an evaluator and a gender activist, but I've been listening to all of you, I've been wondering, you know, we have always been talking about not leaving anybody behind. It's always been sort of lexical. We are using terms all the time just to indicate that there is equity and there is. And I think what we need to do now to actually make a difference and to actually not to leave people behind is we need to think of what should we as evaluators specifically be doing differently. We've been always talking about segregating data, but I think we need to be more focused now. I mean, we have had a lot of segregated data. We've always been talking about gender mainstreaming, and I don't think it got us very much ahead. But I think we need to be thinking about how are we going to be doing that? What kind of questions are we going to be asking? I mean, the stories Ziad just told us, you know, how do we capture this kind of empowerment? It's like, what questions do we ask and who do we ask is, I think, key to what if we are ever going to incur any change in what we're doing. Thank you very much.
Can you pass the mic? Yeah.
Thank you. I'm Fabiola Mariles. I come from Colombia and represent women in management in Latin America, also with links with evaluation. While I was looking at you, I was thinking on that there is something that shouldn't be left behind, that it is the fight of many women and men that in the past have been joining forces to be fight against the inequalities, to create methods and many other forms of fighting against inequalities. So that shouldn't be left behind. That should be considered in order not to be from zero, but to continue that work. And using the example that Ziad put, it is not only to look at the eyes to the landlord, but to own the land that he is owning. So that work of women shouldn't be stopped. And also to be consider the representation too. I hope that in the future, it is not only a cliche, of no one left behind, but also have the representation that we have been fighting for many years, and that this group will be four men and four women to be represented equally.
I am Oluya Mese, representing International Inner Wheel. I'm looking at the possibility of this panel of designing a project that will be of extension service, extension to rural farmers to help them to reduce the time of land preparation, planting, harvesting, and access to collective information. I think this panel should encourage countries, participating countries, to set up extension service in all communities. We will help in food production, surpluses will be sold, economy will increase, there will be enough money to train children, there will be more money in the hands of the woman. He will spend less time in the farm, and the children too will have time for their homework. I think this project should be designed for extension service, helping the NGOs to collect farmers to form a cooperative and get a collective information on the use of herbicides, the use of harvesting, storage, processing semi-finished product for export. I want to implore these countries here, the government here, in all countries that is applicable, that is farm-friendly land, that an extension service program should be established. Thank you.
Thank you. So there is, okay, one. Can you give the mic here? And then over there.
Hi, I'm Dr. Hope Kalman, National Council of Women of the United States. Nice to be here. It's just flew in from Los Angeles. I've been here since as an NGO since the Earth Summit. And we did, I used the metaphor that I was going to miss the bus if I didn't come to this meeting. I think we're missing a very important point, and we're leaving out a female. We're leaving her behind, which is the environment. And I know that we can't do everything, but if we don't address the issue of the environment, we're all going to be left behind. And if I didn't say that today, I wouldn't be using my time appropriately. And I hope that somehow we are able to address this in our relationship to women and equity and how we relate to the environment around us.
Thank you. Yeah, so over there.
Thank you. My name is Isri. I'm from Sri Lanka. I moved here for university, and I'm representing the United Nations Association. So it's both of a comment and a question for Kabir Hashim. So when I was home, I moved here a year and a half ago, but when I was home, my mom and I, we taught a group of kids who were between the ages of 6 and 16, who were from a low financial family background. And ironically, all these kids lived literally a wall away from me. So I was privileged enough to go to a good enough school to learn my English, learn my education. But these kids who were in classes in seventh grade and eighth grade had standards of education, standards of English that I couldn't even think I would have dealt with if I was in a second grade. These kids couldn't put together three words together. And so we used music, we used dance, and we used performance arts to kind of help them understand how they can bridge a sentence together and things like that. So I think what I'm trying to present here is the quality of education in two aspects. One is using, going outside of the STEM field, like you said, using performance arts, because in Sri Lanka, we tend to focus a lot on sports. So if you switch on the TV, you'd see a lot of cricket, but you don't see a lot of representation when it comes to performance arts. So that's one way that kind of helps liberate a child, helps to express a child's motivations or what they want to present to the world. And the second is some of these children are doing their O-levels, which in British standards are the IGCSE exams this year. So I asked them when I went home this time, what are your plans for next year? And some of the girls were, I want to learn how to stitch, I want to learn how to cook. Well, why can't it be outside of that? Why don't you want to be an engineer? Why don't you want to be an actor? Why don't you want to be a dancer? Why don't you want to be something outside of the cultural norm? So I think, I don't know if you agree with me, but my question is, if you do agree, which I hope you do, how do you see us implementing this in Sri Lanka, and how can we make this a positive aspect for the younger generations to come?
Thank you very much.
So I have the mic over here, so just...
Okay.
I'm Sona Zaveri, and I represent Secretary Community of Evaluators South Asia. And we talked a lot about the ownership and the national capacity. We did an e-survey in our region, and what we have, our findings are indicating is that the capacity for evaluations is spread through multi-stakeholders. So when we're talking about national capacity, how do we ensure that we get all of them on board along with the government? And I think that's something that we need to look at. And the second aspect that we understood is that when we are looking at no one left behind, we are looking at complexity in terms of transformation and a lot of the power relations that are existing. So how are evaluations going to be addressing the transformative aspect of the projects that are being evaluated?
Okay, thanks. So before you, just the colleagues, I don't know if it's Florencia or Samar who will read the questions from the online, if you can just pick three questions, and then I will give the floor to you, so please.
Thank you very much. My name is Patricia Munabi. I come from Uganda. And I would like to thank the presenters for everything that they have put out to us. Yes, evaluation is good. Yes, we are very excited about the SDGs. One of the critical challenges for me and which came through is the lack of political will. Many of our countries have indeed signed up to these very good global commitments. We have good commitments on the African continent and even in our own countries, but the lack of political will is glaring. And my question is, can we begin to think about mechanisms that we can use to hold our governments accountable? Because it is not enough to put signatures onto documents and then not have them implemented at the local level. So is there a mechanism in place that can be used to hold our governments accountable? Because the evaluations will be done, the gaps will be identified, and then nothing will be done about them. So can we begin to think about these mechanisms?
Thank you very much. So I would like to move now to the colleagues online. So if you can just read three of the questions, and perhaps also if you can let us know. I'm curious to know how many people is connected online. I don't know if you have it in your screen or not. So please. The mic, sorry, can you give the mic over? Can you give the mic over there?
Yeah, so we are connecting a community of people through Twitter. We don't know really, we don't have the numbers yet on how many people are viewing the event that is being live stream at the moment. But we did get some comments and questions through Twitter. And we have Kelly Bounden from Oxfam, Canada. And so she's asking, how can gender budgeting play a role in holding accountability on the implementation of the SDGs? So that's a little bit going into the gender budgeting issues. We also have Tessie Katsambas, who is asking, how are international organizations promoting the integration of gender in their own programs? So looking a bit at international organizations on their own. We also have Oscar Garcia asking about what should evaluators do to leave no one behind, and really looking at the evaluator's role in this process. Well, those are the three questions for now.
Okay. Thank you very much, I mean, for the very interesting either comments or questions. I'm fully aware that we have only 10, 15 minutes to go. So I would like to ask our panelists maybe just to select one topic. I mean, don't try to address all of them because otherwise I think that our reception is over. So just maybe select one topic and also if you have any final remarks that you would like to make because this will be your last chance to make these final remarks and perhaps we can just simply go through, starting with Thomas and then we just go to this side.
So thank you very much. I'd like to pick up on this issue of accountability because it's true that as the level of ambition of the 2030 agenda rose, as the comprehensiveness became and the integrated nature became evident, the disposition of member states to be accountable to each other was declined very, very quickly. And in the end, basically, the word accountability is mainly used at the level of the national level. And so we have to climb up the slope again and build systems where countries are confident to report to each other. And definitely we will have national reviews. We will have an SDG progress report that is going to provide a systematic aggregation of the indicators according to the targets and goals. We're going to have a global sustainable development report. We're going to have national reviews this year. Already 21 countries have volunteered to be reviewed. Then we will, at the regional level, in some of the regions, they are looking at possibilities of even doing some kinds of peer reviews, but that is left to the countries, countries themselves. Maybe as a closing remark, though, I think that all this will not be of much use if the SDGs and this promise that was made by the leaders to the people doesn't come down to the actual people themselves. They need to know about it. So all these discussions that we had over the last 2 years to make sure that everybody was participating in the debate, that now needs to continue even stronger. We need to make sure that people at the local level discuss the SDGs and what they mean for them. And in order to do that, we can't simplify it. They need to realize that there are very concrete things there for them. I mean, a statistician recently sighed at me, you know, over Twitter, saying, "Oh, this is too complex to follow all these indicators." But the truth is, the people who are concerned, they know whether they have access to education, they know whether they have a legal identity or not, they know whether they have drinking water or not, or whether there's a health post nearby. So we have to bring it down to that level. And in order to do that, we have to make sure that the small script of that social contract is read and that things are not overly simplified. I mean, it's nice, the 5 P's and all that, but you know, in the end, what people need is concrete changes. Thank you.
Habir?
Yeah, I think there was one question that was directly to me about education in Sri Lanka. The positive side is that Sri Lanka has one of the highest literacy rates in the world, has one of the finest education systems, and of course, still we do have problems. In the sense, Sri Lanka has invested a huge amount of money in education and as much as possible tried to reduce the disparities in education between regions to ensure that people right around from rural to urban areas have equal education. We've had teacher training programs, laboratories passed all over, but still there are issues about different standards in schools. But it's more than the framework of education. That problem what you said about language skills is mainly something to do with policy. You know, our policy on education has been changing with political parties changing and governments changing, and that has taken the toll on the system. And English language was a link language. It was used. Sri Lanka is still much ahead comparatively to other countries because if you go to the country, more people speak in English, you can, you know, converse easily. But this is what policy change requires, and for a start, the present government has increased the funding for education in terms of as a percentage of GDP. So that's the first move towards it, and the issues are being addressed very clearly. As you know, with the limited time, I would like to concentrate on the political will, about the lack of political will. Yes, there is a lack of political will from one side, or there was a lack of political will, but don't blame the politicians always. What role does civil society play? Well, look at a politician. I don't need to look at evaluation reports to win an election. It's much easier for me to relate to my direct politics, and I can just win an election. But I'm just volunteering to do this because I think this is good, this is right. That's because civil society also doesn't play its role. How many people, especially in the West, do vote? How many people take the trouble to go and vote? Because if you exercise your vote, then you can put pressure on politicians. And you said, okay, how do you make politicians accountable? Well, you have elections. That's one way of making them accountable. No politician has a permanent job. He can be changed. Well, one way is to make the elections closer. But if civil society can have become more conscious of their requirements and use that pressure, then yes, you can also get politicians to change. From the political side, the political will is increasing because civil society is becoming more conscious of their rights. Now they are asking for more accountability and more transparency. If you look at government changes across the world, there's been most often the change on account of people demanding accountability and transparency. So that's showing that there is signs of people getting involved. So one of the things is putting pressure on politicians. It's a two-way thing. And the developing it up to a stage where we can work together, that's a start that we have started with evaluation, that we have brought politicians, parliamentarians in to work with civil, not only with the evaluation community, not only with agencies, but we are talking about working with the WOPES, with the voluntary organizations. That's an exchange of knowledge, and that's a huge change in a short time. Because we believe that we could make the change. So I think there is a positive in all this. We've started, you know, talking about change, but whether it can really happen. But one way of really making things happen is policy change. So that is why we talked about a national evaluation policy. The moment you make it mandatory, every government has to go by it. So that is one of the reasons we think you need to make policy changes and you need to legislate bills and ensure that Parliament safeguards those rights.
Thanks a lot. Susan?
Yeah, thank you. I would like to comment on somebody who talked about no one left behind just becoming a term and then, or a slogan, and then we forget about it. I think I want to agree that many times that does happen. As I have seen as having things like health for all by the year 2000. The year 2000 came and went, and health for all was never achieved. Water for all by such and such. But I'm thinking that no one left behind. If everybody is interested in this, and if we can make people interested, we can all participate. This is a time that communication, information reaches people so fast. We are getting questions from Canada, from all over. And using that opportunity, we can make everybody know and people become more involved, which in fact, no one left behind is a bottom-up approach rather than an up-down approach. And it is important that all this, we take a responsibility and involve people, because SDGs, they're so broad. They touch everything, everybody, and every country should be involved in one way or another, and much more the developing countries. So really, I don't think this is a term that should just come and go. It is a term that we will get involved with and use it for the benefit of everybody. The issue of political will was well expounded on. I only want to add that politicians come and go, but governments are always there, and it is important for the government itself, the government in power, to take up the issues of SDGs, internalize them, and also participate in strengthening the bodies that are involved in national evaluation. And therefore, and then we should be able to move together.
Thank you very much.
And thank you. We got very beautiful discussion and so many questions, suggestions and comment. I want to pick up one word, that is budget. To implement any project, to get the target, we need to have money, budget. You see, every year we allocate budget for the development perspective, and donor committee, financial institution also provide money in the name of grants, loans, and other things. But the budget which channelize, before channelize the budget, there is so many preconditions. The underdeveloped country and developed country fail to fulfill the precondition of the donor. That is the most important obstacle to implement development budget in underdeveloped country or developing country. So many goals, targets, and campaign we launched previously. Now we are going to launch another big campaign, that is SDG. Then now, so many developed countries and donor communities committed to big amount of budget to invest to the certain communities, certain underdeveloped country or developing country. But underdeveloped country and developed country fail to meet their precondition, then they cannot meet their goal. And second thing, the underdeveloped and developing countries are prisoned with the global agenda. Yeah, global agenda. Then they cannot meet the campaign of the global agenda. That is another difficulty to address the global agenda. They are in under pressure of the international agenda. Second thing. Third thing, if you want to implement these things properly and effectively, there should be separate national budget code, SDG budget code. We have to call the people, call the country to make separate budget code, that is that will help to get the objective. And one thing is separate budget code. Another thing, we have to make one sovereign budget fund. We have to allocate some budget in the heading of the sovereign budget fund, and some other money we get from the donors and developed country, that should go to the sovereign budget fund. Then country, the developer and underdeveloped country, can mobilize their budget independently without precondition. In this stage, they can do very correctly, very effectively, and they can get the SDG goal also. Otherwise, we can repeat the history day by day. Then I request all the donor committees, especially World Bank representatives over here, they should be more democratic rather than before, to invest the budget, to channelize the budget, and then developing country can meet their target. I request all the donor committee, all the UN agency also. Then one thing. Second thing, we are talking about politics and evaluation, and politician and evaluation. We know there is so many policies, but politics is the guardian of all the policies, or the mother of all the policies. Without correction of the politics, we fail to get the development agenda. We fail to satisfy the people's aspiration or people's need. Then this evaluation policy supervises monitoring this leadership honesty, leadership commitment, leadership will, and with their vision, they can help to meet the goal, SDG goal, and other things. Then my concern,
there is the democratization for the channelize of fund. There is a separate budget code for the meet the SDG development goal. Then there should be this separate the sovereign budget fund to the respective country to channelize the budget in this heading. And politicians should be disciplined, and there should be bridging between politician and civil society. Then Global Parliament Forum try to bridging between the civil society and politician. It will be the great achievement of this century, I think, of the century in the regards of the evaluation policy. I say thank you all the community evaluators who always trying to meet the politician and backing to the politician in the since history. Now you got, you come in the point, politicians are ready to support the community evaluators and other people who are working to the anti-corruption governance and to monitoring this the development target and their lapses. Thank you, Paral.
Thank you. Ziad?
Yes, we have until 6?
No.
We don't have until 6.
No,
because
we have until
we have
three
a very
minutes.
Important question that we need to answer. What evaluators need to do to make sure that nobody is left behind? Gosh, Oscar. yeah, I mean, that's an amazing question that requests an answer in 1 minute, of which 30 seconds are gone in preamble. Nevertheless, I think that, or we believe that evaluators need to be the custodians of this whole process and need to trust more that their role transcends beyond examining relevance and judging effectiveness and you know, assessing efficiency and what have you, to kind of look at the dead angles, ask the right questions, challenge the mindsets, etc. And this has been at the core of the support that IOCE and Eval Partners are providing to the, it's a new acronym, VOPES, which are the Voluntary Organizations for Professional Evaluation, which are the evaluation societies all across. Interestingly, in the process of discussing the global evaluation agenda, when we talked about the professionalization of evaluators in terms of profession, like explaining to a child, what do you do if you're an evaluator, which I still face problems with my children until now. The mindset was, don't talk about the professionalization of evaluators, talk about the professionalization of evaluation in the sense that evaluators are part of a continuum. The commissioners are as important as the evaluators are. The users, the policymakers, the society at large. And hence, that was a big paradigm shift in the global agenda. Again, this is an unconditional marketing. Go look at it. Search for your bite of the apple in order to be able to advance together. And last but not least, I'd say I don't want to leave anyone behind. I just want to bring everybody on board. Like, look at it from a positive rather than negative. Leaving, let's get everybody on board, even if we have to take the first main bus and then a special and maybe a third bus.
Thanks. Nick?
Okay, well, I just want to give an example of how evaluation can help on the accountability side. Because I got a strong sense of people feeling a bit of frustration that the underlying parameters are staying fixed despite the stuff that's happening on top, and I completely agree with that because I see that. So I think a couple of things we can do. One is to focus on evaluating interventions that do change the balance of power that excludes certain groups. So focus on interventions around voice, for example. Focus around interventions to do with the democratic system, the way funds are used, transparency, and many other things. Include civil society organizations more in our evaluations. I think often donors tend to focus on the donors, and this CSO angle on it tends not to get as big a prominence as it should. But I actually saw a very nice example of evaluation being used to hold governments to account when I recently visited a country, I won't say which, but we were doing a dissemination in a country which we had evaluated, and I was on a panel like this, and there was a very impassioned and articulate and impressive speech from a young person from a civil society organization using the evidence from the evaluation, directing it at the government representative and saying, this is not good enough, what are you doing about it? And that was in the capital, in front of a large audience, and it was covered by the media. And they were using the evidence from the evaluation. So I think one of the things evaluators can do is create the evidence by which domestic accountability can work. And it has to be domestic accountability. It can't be about us telling, you know, creating a national mandate from DC or from New York. It has to be driven locally. And so that's why I think focusing on the interventions which change the system and build institutions should be a priority. Otherwise, we'll still be going around some of these loops in 10 years' time. I do see progress. I mean, you talked about professionalization of evaluation. I spoke at the launch of the relaunch of the Kenyan Evaluation Society 3 or 4 years ago. Susan and I were just talking about that. I gather it's going from strength to strength now, is continuing to develop, and it got an injection in the arm then, and these are the way things start and they develop. Yep. And I do see a major progress in capacity while I've been working in development from southern countries who are now, some of them, leading the way and teaching other people how to do it.
Well, thank you very much to the panelists and also to the audience for a very fascinating discussion. I will not attempt to summarize because that would really take too long. By the way, there will be the recording of the videos, plus there will be a report of this session, so everything will be there. But perhaps just to highlight 4 takeaway messages before giving the floor to the ambassador of Sri Lanka for the official closing. Just very simple messages. The first one is that clearly evaluation has a key role to play to enable that SDGs will leave no one behind. The second is that to do that, we need to strengthen national evaluation capacities, both the capacities of to demand and to use this kind of evaluation, as well as the capacity to supply these kind of evaluations. The third takeaway message is that this is going to be a big challenge, and that's why we need partnerships. We need partnership to ensure that this will happen. And we need a multi-stakeholder and diverse partnership. And here we have just an example: government, parliamentarian, civil society, international organizations, all together on this. Because as Thomas reminded us, the SDGs is not just about a lock frame, but is really about a shared vision for humanities. And therefore, really the importance of these social contracts between rights holder and duty bearers. And I think that we also, from the evaluation side, we have to make sure that this social contract, that we have a social contract among evaluators, but also a social contract between policymakers and evaluators to make this work out. So with this, I would like to invite the Ambassador Pereira from the Sri Lanka mission to the UN here in New York, please, to the podium to make the official closing remarks.
Distinguished panelists, moderator, Mr. Marco Sigone, ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to make these brief closing remarks at the invitation of UN Women and to bring to a close a most stimulating afternoon in which there was a very interesting panel discussion followed by a similarly stimulating interactive session. For us at the Permanent Mission of Sri Lanka, it has been a privilege to be associated with UN Women, Evalgender, and all the other collaborators in making this event possible today on the sidelines of CSW, which is meeting since Monday. The enriching discussion we had this evening brings into sharp focus the need to evaluate our commitments, which the leaders made in September 2015, in a manner that would ensure that we carry with us on this 15-year journey every single human being, that we evolve development processes that are people-centered, gender-sensitive, respectful of human rights, and focus on the marginalized, poorest, and most vulnerable among us. Now, this, I believe, is at the core of the phrase which we discussed this evening, leave no one behind. It is true that each member state will have its own set of challenges as it begins to integrate the SDGs into its national plans and policies and seek to strengthen national capacities. Nevertheless, it is global fora such as these that will provide the platform for all of us to learn from each other. Events such as these will foster knowledge, knowledge sharing, peer review, and reciprocal learning across regions that will no doubt help each of our nations at the national levels to implement the goals even as we draw inspiration from each other's experiences and challenges. Surely, there's no better time than to focus our attention on the pivotal role played by women in development than right now. We are in the 21st year of the Beijing Platform for Action, which called for strengthening accountability mechanisms for gender equality, including of national gender equality mechanisms, national human rights institutions, and regulatory bodies. The CSW this year and all its surrounding events are of vital importance and generates the necessary momentum as we begin our journey towards the achievement of the SDGs and as we clarify the centrality of gender inequalities and gender power relations as well as women's contribution to sustainable development. We must not forget that all the effects of unsustainable patterns of development intensify gender inequality as women and girls are often affected by economic, social, and environmental shocks disproportionately. Our path to sustainable development must always take this fact into consideration as well. And this, I think, came out very, very clearly in the discussion we had this evening. The achievement of full human potential and of sustainable development is not possible if one half of humanity, women and girls, continue to be denied its full human rights and opportunities. Therefore, we strongly believe that the systematic mainstreaming of a gender perspective in the implementation of the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development is critical. This is a central message that has come out through this discussion today. In closing, I'd like to thank once again UN Women and all the other co-sponsors, including the Permanent Mission of Switzerland, and also the distinguished panelists, which included key policymakers, including parliamentarians, for making this event an enriching learning experience for us all. I would like to reiterate Sri Lanka's continuing commitment to gender equality, which is not only a fundamental human right, but a necessary foundation for a peaceful, prosperous, and a sustainable world. I thank you all.
Workshop, so please join us tomorrow at 9. And once again, the last round of applause for all the panelists, the organizer, and all of us for the very interesting panel. And now it's time for the music and the reception.